Humanity today faces several major global challenges. But as a medical doctor and a climate activist, I will highlight two of these challenges today. And both are urgent, and women are a key part of the solution. The first is about climate change and the environment, and the second is about global health. Until now, these challenges have been seen as separate issues. The fact is, however, that they are highly interconnected. And a lot of this has to do with food and the way we produce it. And we want to succeed in tackling these challenges related to food, health, and sustainability without a new, holistic, integrated approach. And using we, it literally means us. Us. Because women play a key role in the transition towards healthier diets and more sustainable food production. So, in other words, ladies, we are shouldered by a historically responsibility. I will get back to why women, in particular women from developing countries, play a key role in solving these issues, and how we can ensure that these women become the change makers we are dependent upon. But before jumping to solutions, let me spend a few minutes addressing these challenges. During the last few decades, there has been a dramatic shift in the global burden of disease. For the first time in history, more people die from obesity than hunger. While almost 900 million still go hungry every day, more than 2 billion people are now either overweight or obese. And overweight and obesity is a major risk factor for non-communicable diseases, such as cardiovascular disease, cancers, diabetes type 2. And these chronic lifestyle-related diseases have now outpassed infectious diseases in terms of absolute numbers, becoming the world's biggest killer, accounting for 63% of the global annual deaths. These chronic diseases used to be a Western phenomenon. It's not anymore. These diseases are now increasing fastest in the low and middle-income countries, where 80% of the premature deaths before the age of 60, occur. So while these countries are still struggling with hunger and malnutrition, developing countries now face a double burden of disease. And this represents a major barrier to economic development and to equality. And bad food, unhealthy diets, is a major driver of this epidemic. But what we put on our plate is not only a matter for our personal health, it's also a matter for the health of the planet. Did you know that the agriculture sector today is the world's single biggest emitter and accounts for as much as 20 to 30% of the global greenhouse gas emissions? And that's more than the transport sector. In addition, food production, the global food system, is the single most important driver of deforestation, loss of biodiversity, depletion of marine ecosystems, land use change, and consumption of human freshwater. And what kind of food we produce really does matter. For example, meat production is enormously environmental footprints compared to that of growing plants such as grains and vegetables. Indeed, the meat industry alone accounts for as much as 15% of the global emissions and occupies 2/3 of the world's available agricultural land. Indisputably, our food system is putting the planet under extreme pressure. At the same time, one-third of all food produced never gets eaten. It's either lost or wasted down the food value chain. And this is not only terrible, it's dramatic. Because in less than 4 decades, we will have another 2 billion mouths to feed. And with the current trends in economic development and changing dietary preferences, food production will have to increase by 60% by mid-century to meet the growing demand. I think we all agree that we don't need a rocket scientist to draw the conclusion. The current food system is broken and change is inevitable. To feed 9 billion healthy people on a stable planet, we will have to produce more food in a more sustainable way. But changing the global food system is not possible without involving half the world's population. Not only because 70% of the world's smallholder farmers are women, or because women are the key stakeholders on children's and families' dietary choices, but because as the population growth will occur in Africa and in Asia, most of the expected increase in food production will have to occur on these continents. Today, smallholder farmers, women, tend to produce less food than their male counterparts. But if women had the same access to information and productive resources as men, they could increase yields on their farm by up to 30%. And therefore, we must facilitate women's opportunities not only to produce food to keep their families alive, but to produce food for the market, in order for those who are not owning land also to benefit from the increased food production. The question is not whether if we should do this. The question is, how can we do this? And coming from academia, I strongly believe in evidence-based knowledge, and I believe that science holds the key to a sustainable future. The triple helix of food, health, and sustainability has proven inseparable when it comes to examining the current state of the world. We need more interdisciplinary knowledge, but evidence alone has probably never really changed the world. Knowledge must be translated into practice. And historically, all paradigm shifts has come as a result of another triple helix, that of science, business, and politics. And business has to become part of the solution, not only part of the problem. But in order for business to operate and innovate in the desired direction, predictability and the right types of regulations and incentives are required. And therefore, the policymakers have to be on board. I strongly believe that this double triple helix, representing food, health, sustainability on the one hand, and science, business, and politics on the other, is a recipe for change. And I also believe that this recipe can be applied to women, facilitating their role as a catalyst in the required sustainable, healthy food revolution. Let me give you a concrete example. A few weeks ago in Sweden, the inaugural Eat Stockholm Food Forum gathered 400 delegates from 28 countries, among them some of the world's most influential and important experts from science, business, and politics. And these people met in Stockholm to discuss challenges related to food, health, and sustainability. Together with Johan Rockström and the Stockholm Resilience Center, we started the EAT initiative to catalyze change in the global food system. In addition to offering an annual platform, EAT creates a long-term collaborative network of research institutions, universities, NGOs, trade unions, and corporate companies. And the objective of the ETH initiative is to spur more interdisciplinary research, facilitate innovation and broadcast best practice from industry, encourage development of new policies, and last but not least, facilitate behavioral change at scale. And I believe a similar alliance for policymakers, scientists, and business is required to succeed in changing the framework to empower women. And I believe that a closer collaboration with corporate companies is crucial because more sustainable capitalism is key to change. Not only globally, this mentality has to be applied locally to raise small-scale farming to a sustainable future level. This radical shift, however, requires much more than microcredit. And as one of the keynote speakers at the EAT Forum said, Mr. Chibonga, he is the CEO of the National Smallholder Farmers Alliance in Malawi, he stated, we need a paradigm shift in small-scale farming, going from subsistence to farming business. And knowing whom these small-scale farmers are, there is no doubt that we need a new approach. We can't solve future problems with tools of the past. And I will sum up. I assume that the most frequent word here at Nordic Forum is gender equality. And although there is still a way to go, the increasing equality between men and women has really changed Europe. And now it's time to apply the same recipe on the remaining parts of the world. As brave women have done in generations before us, we must act and we will succeed. Because this time, the alternative is simply not an option.